Christmas celebration right after church, so come over and eat. In case you did not know, still come over and eat now. The announcements in the bulletin, November 30th through January 4th, there's a Life After Loss grief support. Is it a six-week deal?
6 weeks, yeah.
Okay. All are welcome to go. It doesn't matter if it's been recent or it's been a while. You're all welcome. It's 6:30 to 8:30, and it'll be here at Bethany. December 7th is going to be a stewardship committee meeting at 2 p.m. December 12th is the third Sunday of Advent. We're also going to have a board meeting at 5. And then Christmas Eve is on the 24th. Next day is Christmas, and we all expect to see y'all bright and bushy-tailed on the 26th, right? That's right. Everybody here. So, next, we're going to light the Advent candle and the story of the wreath.
Whether the wreath you made is a craft.
children. Is that next? Yep. Oh, no, just kidding. I was supposed to do the responsive reading. I kind of got out of order there for a minute. Sorry. Yeah, could you please join me in the responsive reading? Thank you. Today we relight the candle of hope. Now we light the candle for the second Sunday in Advent. This is the candle of peace. As we prepare for the coming of Jesus, we remember that Jesus is our hope and our peace, from the prophet Isaiah.
For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
From the Gospel of John.
Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid.
And then we lit the candle.
Grant that we may find peace as we prepare for our Lord's birth. May divisions in ourselves and in our families be peacefully resolved. May there be peace in our cities and in the countries of our world. Help us to see the paths of peace in our lives, and then give us the courage to follow them. Lord, let us remember that you only are the giver of lasting peace, and that you are always with us. Amen.
Now may we have the children come forward. Oh, do we? I am so sorry. I just all kinds of out of order.
It came upon the midnight clear, that glorious song of old, from angels bending near the earth to touch their hearts of gold. Peace on the earth, goodwill to men from hands of gracious King. The world in solemn stillness lay to hear the angels sing. Still through the golden skies they come with peaceful wings unfurled, and still their heads.
Thank you. Thank you. Gavin, most people really prefer that, the recorded music, and I'm getting the same way. I am, because I have to lead the music often with church in churches and nobody sings. You ask them to sing and they just, or they say watermelon. Some pretty songs. Glad y'all are all here. Glad you're here, and I hope you're all planning on staying for the meal. And a thank you to all of you who have helped prepare the meal. All of the preparations that you've made are appreciated already. When it came down to cooking or cutting the meat up or whatever you did, we appreciate it so very, very much. We're grateful that you're here. We're grateful also for any guests. Most of you are family who are visiting with other family. Maggie is a guest. Maggie, just kind of lift your hand a little bit there so that people will be able to get to know you. Maggie's been attending our grief, our life after loss, and glad of that too. But she's also glad as a guest that she's here today. Any of you are invited to come and join us for that life after loss. It's offered for your benefit. And so the few that we have coming, we have about five or six coming, which is about normal, really, for most of them that I've done. I've done many, many, many of them, not hundreds, but many, many, many of them. But we usually get up to about 14 and try to cut it off there if we can. So if you'd like to come, it's you're very, very welcome. Had a great article. I noticed our fellow pastor across town, she had an article in the paper today that dealt with grief and with how grief affects you and how to deal with your loss. And that's really, really helpful. That's some of the stuff that we deal with in the time that we spend together in life after loss. You'll be welcome to come and visit us. We spend 2 hours on Tuesdays doing it, and in that 2 hours we have an hour of a little bit of a video and then some discussion, some refreshments, and then have some discussion and question and answer afterwards. It's a good, in the second hour, it's a good time to be able to review and to deal with some of the things that have been dealt with in our past. I want to say thank you also for all of you that do children's messages. Thank you for all the time that you put into them. It means a great deal to me. My mentor in the doctoral program was a pastor who had written his dissertation on the children's message. That's what he had done it on. And so he was a very good friend of mine. He eventually became the president of Buckner Benevolences. And then after directing that for a long time, he's now retired. Very, very good friend, but he and his research, since I had to understand his research for him to help me with mine, he had researched it and discovered that the children's message usually contains enough information, because it's concentrated, that it would cover 3 weeks' worth of Sunday school. How about that? So, in the children's message, how very vital that it is. It really makes a difference in children's lives. It helps them. So I appreciate those of you that do what you do for that. As we come to a time of prayer, there's a lot of people that we need room for in prayer. I had a busy week with funerals. I had 4 funerals this week and didn't get out to make as many visits as I wanted to make with other people. But how's Gail doing?
She's doing better.
All right.
Yeah,
all right.
She's just learning to walk again.
And eat. Learning to walk and eat, because she wasn't eating last time I visited with her very much at all. Yes. Paula Smith is still away, isn't she? She's still traveling. She got home? Okay, good. Made the trip well, I suspect. All right. Anybody know? Anybody had a chance to visit with her? Sandra Cox is still making her recovery. Don Riggs' sister continued to remember her in prayer, but has such a wonderful attitude about it. Kay Tomlinson, I really was planning to get by there today. This week, because we were going to have a hospice tea there, and I thought, well, it'd be great to get to see her, but Madison canceled their tea, and so I ended up having to go somewhere else. But they'll have it eventually. How's she doing?
She said that she should be released tomorrow.
Coming home? We'll put a list at the back of the church for any mother-in-laws or mothers that we need you to take care of them for us. And if you would like to adopt them, I have one too. If you would like to adopt them, then you may. We'll leave them back there for you to adopt. I do want you to continue to remember the family of April Braswell. I'll be traveling this next weekend up St. Louis to get to visit with them and to help with that memorial service. KC will be here, though. KC Blackadder will be here as my substitute, and he's excited. He's called me twice already, and he's really excited about getting to come. And I said, I'm so glad you're excited, KC. They'll be looking forward to you. Just making an Advent message. I won't tell you what to preach. Just you come preach and let them know. So he's looking forward to being here with you. So know that. So I know that you're in good hands, as you always are. But please remember us with April, and that service will be on Saturday, and I'll be traveling about this time, coming back home. And I hate flying, quite frankly. So pray for me, and we'll get kicked off the plane, because I don't like flying at all. Who else do you want to remember in prayer? Yes, ma'am. Oh, thank you for that.
She's small.
Yes.
And I'd like to ask for prayers for the Christopher Samaya family, but not the Lady.
Okay. Family yesterday that I dealt with, wife, she got put in the hospital with COVID, wasn't able to come to the funeral. Really sad time for a lot of families had COVID. It's still out there and it's still rampant and making some difficult times for families. Thank you. Yes, that makes it even more difficult because exposure, if I get exposed, I can't go to work. I have to end up having to stay off for 14 days just for exposure, and so I have to stay away from the people at the funerals, have to keep them at a distance and wear a mask and all of the stuff that goes with it. And it's still sad. We're dealing with it. We'll get there. God's going to get us there one way or another with all the savagery that has brought on the world. And it has brought a lot of savagery. Who else do you want to remember in prayer? Okay, let's pray. God, we do love you so very much. And Father, we bring prayer requests to you because that's part of the worship that we have. And it's part of our comfort that comes by sharing prayer requests with each other, Lord Jesus, and knowing that we've given you the burdens that we feel. And those burdens are great, Lord. And we've mentioned them already. We won't mention them twice. You've heard us, and you know them already. And you know beyond that, you know all the prayer requests that we have in our hearts. In our hearts, we have prayer requests for the changing world that we live in and for the changing nature of schools. And Father, everything that's happened, it still continues to change and make a big impact upon the world. Help us as we deal with it. Help us as we minister. Bless the congregation next week, Lord Jesus. Make it a great time. Casey being here and having a renewal of friendship, a good worship. Then, Father, I pray earnestly that you help us with the fellow churches and the other communities in Odessa in particular, communities of faith, that we continue to encourage one another, Lord Jesus, because many of them are also having the same kind of difficulties even that we have when it comes to dealing with the COVID. Father, we pray earnestly your blessing as we go through Advent. Make it a time of celebration and worship of you. Now as you enter, we continue worship, even as you've taught us to pray, we pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Sing again. Let's pray for her right here. Lord Jesus, we pray for Sue. Pray for Sue in her grief. Lord Jesus, continue to help her. Give her comfort and from supernatural means, Lord, strength. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Call and cheer. Our spirits heavenly home. Make safe the way that leads on high, and close the path to misery.
The Bible says we should bring our tithes and offerings into the storehouse,
stand together as we sing the doxology. Lord Jesus, we ask earnestly your blessing upon our offering, the giving in representation of all that we are, the giving of ourselves to you in service. We love you. Bless our service in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. I'm going to be reading out of Luke chapter 1 and 2, portions of those chapters. From Luke chapter 1 first, beginning with verse 5. In the time of Herod, king of Judah, there was a priest named Zechariah who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. His wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. Both of them were upright in the sight of God, observing all the Lord's commandments and regulations blamelessly. But they had no children, because Elizabeth was barren, and they were both well along in years. Once when Zechariah's division was on duty and he was serving as priest before God, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to go to the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And when the time of the burning of incense came, all the assembled worshipers were praying outside. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Don't be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to give him the name John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from birth. Many of the people of the Lord will he bring back to the Lord their God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom and the righteousness, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Zechariah asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I am an old man, and my wife is well along in years." The angel answered, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God and have been sent to speak to you and to tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day that this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their proper time." Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondering why he stayed so long in the temple. When he came out, he could not speak to them. They realized he had seen a vision in the temple, for he kept making signs to them but remained unable to speak. When his time of service was completed, he returned home. After this, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant and for 5 months remained in seclusion. "The Lord has done this for me," she said. "In these days he has shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people." The maturity of us in the Holy Spirit is manifested in a variety of ways, and in these Christmas Advent messages and the women of Christmas, we're going to talk about those aspects of maturity in the Holy Spirit. Today we want to talk about courage. Courage coming and giving us a sense of peace. Maturity of the Holy Spirit is reflected in these women's of Christmas, and the first is reflected in the courage of Elizabeth. She and her husband were good servant people. Now in their old age, they had been childless, and that was a sad, sad thing for them in those days not to have a child. Sad, and she also was judged in the eyes of other people. She was a failure, but she remained faithful, which was a remarkable thing in those days for a woman like her. It's so easy for we believers to get used to being blessed by God with his protection and his care that when something bad or sad or something that makes us mad comes along, we get discouraged. We think that God has forgotten us or that we've done something wrong, and therefore God is punishing us by it. God's uncomfortable grace is something that you and I, and his graceful working with us in this life, is something we have to learn to accept. We just don't know where God is going to be showing up, but he shows up. That uncomfortable grace is taking us somewhere. What is that uncomfortable grace? It's the things that are sad or uncomfortable or things that make us mad or things that aren't the way that we want them to be. In God's grace, he says, this is uncomfortable for you, but it is the grace that I'm bringing to you through it that's important. I'm taking you somewhere with this journey. To remain courageous during those times is a hard thing. To remain courageous when things are not going your way or haven't happened the way that you think that they should. She remained so. She didn't try to force the issue. She didn't try to place the blame on somebody else, on her husband. She trusted God to be in charge, not her. And finally, when the announcement was made to Zechariah was startled. He was in the temple when the angel appeared to him and told him that God was going to wrought this miracle in him. And the thing that scared him the most was that he knew that God had not spoken through the prophets for 400 years, nor had there been any kind of revelation to them for 400 years. Now, that's courage, is waiting on God. If we don't have some kind of miraculous appearance to us, people become so unfaithful over a period of time. And yet that miraculous appearance can come in so many ways, little miraculous appearances from God to you, little guidances that he brings to us make all the difference. For Zechariah, there had not been one that was large for 400 years. And so when God says, the angel says to him that his barren wife is going to have a child, he thinks it is remarkable. And it is remarkable. Remarkable that it would happen. Continuing in Luke chapter 1, the story continues in verse 39. At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leapt for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that what the Lord has said to her will be accomplished." And then jumping forward a little bit down to verse 56. Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home. When it was time for Elizabeth to have her baby, she gave birth to a son. Her neighbors and relatives heard that the Lord had shown her great mercy, and they shared in her joy. On the eighth day, they came to circumcise the child, and they were going to name him after his father Zechariah. But his mother spoke up and said, "No, he is to be called John." They said to her, "There's no one among your relatives who has that name." And then they made signs to his father to find out what he would like to name the child. He asked for a writing tablet, and to everyone's astonishment, he wrote, "His name is John." Immediately, his mouth was opened and his tongue was loosed, and he began to speak, praising God. The neighbors were all filled with awe, and throughout the hill country of Judea, people were talking about all these things. Everyone who heard this wondered about it, asking, "What then is this child going to be? For the Lord's hand is with him." Age doesn't matter to God. Did you learn that? Age doesn't matter to God. He uses you regardless of your age. At any age, we can serve him and find him using us in miraculous ways. Elizabeth carrying the baby in old age was also an expression of the courage of maturity in the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit had come into her, and that maturity was being expressed. People realized that this child is going to be special. Something about this child is unique. Zechariah, in the last passage we're going to read, praises God for all that's happened now. Again, taking from Luke chapter 1, beginning with verse 67. His father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, "Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he's come and has redeemed his people. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he said through his holy prophets of long ago, salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy on our fathers and to remember his holy covenant, the oath he swore to our father Abraham, to rescue us from the hand of our enemies, to enable us to serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, my child, will be called a prophet of the Most High, for you will go on before the Lord to prepare the way for him, to give his people the knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of their sins, because of the tender mercy of our God, by which the rising sun will come to us from heaven, to shine on those living in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into a path of peace. The child grew, became strong in spirit, and he lived in the desert until he appeared publicly before Israel. The Holy Spirit revealed to Zechariah who Jesus was and who John was and the role that both were to play. And that was a magnificent manifestation. It's the same kind of manifestation that has to come to each of us, though. And it is miraculous. I was discussing with someone just the other day, a family member, and we were discussing family members who had not become Christians yet, and that we continue to witness to and continue to encourage to. And I said, you know, wouldn't it be miraculous if we could just pull their chest open and stuff Jesus in, and then they would go, how wonderful that is. And they would be fine. I said, yes, that would be great if we could do that, but we can't. And so we go on, we continue on with knowing who God is, knowing who Jesus is, and knowing the manifestation that he's brought to us, and the goodness, the holiness, and righteousness, and good way of living, the forgiveness that he's brought to us, the help that he brings to us daily. And we simply continue to pray for those who are family and friends, asking that God might reveal himself to them in time. But he has to reveal himself the same way that he revealed himself to you. He has to be just as original with them as he is with you. And being patient with it is a hard thing. To bring salvation through the forgiveness of sins and enable us to serve God in holiness and righteousness all in our days is a miraculous thing, something that only God can bring. We pray for it, and we want to be used as tools to help bring it to those friends and family members, but only God can deliver. Would you bow your heads? In these moments in Christmas time, as we get ready to go to our meal here in a moment, I know that you're aware of people in your life, friends and family members who haven't come to know the Lord Jesus. Right where you are, just say, Lord, I'm not asking for more responsibility, but what I'm asking for is opportunity that somehow through my life and somehow through the natural things that I share, that my family might be able to hear the gospel some way this year and in this Christmas. The world spins on the axis of Christmas. It is a reminder to the rest of the world how important Christmas is. But the world also has to be revealed to them how merciful and gracious Jesus is, that they too can become a part of the family. Just ask God to use you this year in celebrating who he is with not just family, but even others that are around you. Music's going to play, and as it plays, you continue in the spirit of prayer for here for just a few minutes. We're not going to be long. Ask that God might do in your heart what needs to be done in just preparing you for those days.
Fear.